Hello everybody and welcome to today's Chrissy B Show. Today we're going to be touching on a topic that affects everyone at some point in their life, which is stress. Stress is normally associated with unexpected negative events such as losing a job or even a loved one. But stress can also come with positive changes, such as getting married or starting a new business. When there's some sort of change, we have to adapt and it can feel we're not in control of our life, and this can sometimes lead to even anxiety and depression. Today we'll be meeting a brave guest, Katie Beard, who suffers from depression and anxiety. So we want to relieve just a bit of that stress today by showing her she's special and treating her to a makeover right here on the show. Last week we had the pleasure of making over Donna Walker Dean, who was nominated by her wonderful son Thomas O'Connor. During the show we heard how mum Donna was left to cope after her partner was beaten up badly by 9 men in an unprovoked attack, causing severe brain damage that left him wheelchair bound. Despite all she'd been through, Donna managed to keep everything together, making her a super mum in our books. So we're going to meet our next lovely lady soon, who's been through a tough time, but before that let me ask you this. Do you know someone who deserves a makeover? Maybe you know someone who's gone through a difficult time and is deserving of a bit of pampering. Or maybe it's someone that manages to put everyone else before themselves and doesn't take any time out for just them. So if you do know someone like this, or even if you'd like to nominate yourself, you can do that too. You can visit the website chrissybshow.tv and send us a message from there. Or you can also tweet us at Chrissy B Show or leave a message on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. So Kate has already started her makeover and we can see her in the makeup room right now. And she's in there with the Gregoire sisters, our fashion stylist Cynthia and makeup artist Megan. And we'll be talking to them and Katie later on and also seeing the makeover results too. Plus later, I'll be sharing with you my own tips on how to deal with stress. But first, it's the news with the lovely Excel Ashiamomo. Hello, Excel.
Oh, hello, Chrissy.
Have you ever been through stressful situations?
Oh, God, it's every day of the week, every day of the year. My goodness.
But, well, your line of work is pretty stressful as well.
Absolutely. I was going to say, it's the line of work I'm in as well, because dealing with other people's stresses can be somewhat stressful. Mm-hmm. But I think it has its positive sides. Yeah. And, you know, I look forward to it every day, because no 2 days are ever the same. I mean, what you said there in the introduction is quite important, because stress can be seen as something positive. But I think that's something I suppose my mental health professionals sort of tend to argue about, to say whether or not, you know, is there really any such thing as good stress? When I was looking up, following up my research, I found a lot of, I suppose, American definition of it, the good stress, is called eustress. So that's E-U stress, eustress okay. is pronounced. And eustress, they're saying, is the good stress that motivates you to continue working. Stress can be a motivator and provide incentive to get the job done. This good stress is what eustress can be identified as, and some people enjoy it. Everyone needs a bit of stress in their life in order to continue to be happy, motivated, challenged, and productive. It is when this stress is no longer tolerable and or manageable that distress come in. Mm-hmm. So there we know there that negative stress is distress. So this is when the good stress, according to this definition, when the good stress becomes too much to bear or cope with, tension builds and there is no longer any fun in the challenge and there seems to be no relief or no end in sight. Mm-hmm. This is the kind of stress that most of us are familiar with, and this is the kind of stress that leads to poor decision making. And the physiological things that can happen, which should I be identifying as well, is increase in blood pressure, rapid breathing, and generalized tension, and behavioral symptoms as well, such as overeating, loss of appetite, drinking, smoking, and negative coping mechanisms. And I think as well, where I said the sort of like the argument comes in to say, is stress ever a good thing? It talks about stress tolerance is the power to endure stress. So everybody has different levels of stress mm-hmm. tolerance. And, you know, whether you feel something that might be stressful for one person might not be stressful for another person. Like some people would say they work well with deadlines, for example. If you give them you've got an hour to submit this, they'll be like, yeah, I'll get on right, and they'll come out with a beautiful piece of work. Whereas other people, they need a week to get ready. Mm-hmm. And even then that's stressful and they're still kind of like, oh, well, I can't do this. So it's not so much of the fact that it's a particular type of stress that's bad or good, but it's down to the person's ability to cope with, the person's tolerance levels.
I mean, no, maybe even the second person that you mentioned in that scenario, Excel, maybe they're even capable of doing it within the hour, but just the thought that they're under pressure and that they have this, they have to do it by a certain time, that's what stresses them out. It's not because they're not capable.
Exactly.
They just don't like
working. They just don't like to be given that restriction. Yeah. Like, that's exactly, that's exactly that as well. It plays a part, because I think another important thing, another important definition, exactly what you just said there, is linked to this definition, which I found on the mentalhealth.org.uk website, where it says, stress can be defined as the way you feel when you're under abnormal pressure. So all sorts of situations can cause stress. The most common involve work, money matters, and relationships with partners, children, or other family members. Stress may be caused either by major upheavals and life events, such as divorce, unemployment, moving house, and bereavement, or by a series of minor irritations, such as feeling undervalued at work or dealing with difficult children. And sometimes there are no obvious causes. Indeed. So stressful events that are outside the range of normal human experience, for example, being abused or being tortured, may lead to post-traumatic stress disorder, which is commonly known as PTSD. Again, symptoms of stress, like we talked about earlier, physical changes that happen. Your body produces more of the flight or fight chemicals that we commonly hear about, and this prepares your body for an emergency. So imagine there's two main chemicals that get released, called adrenaline and noradrenaline, and these raise your blood pressure and increase your heart rate and increase the rate at which you perspire, and they also reduce blood flow to your skin and reduce your stomach activity. So cortisol releases fat and sugar into the system, to the body, but it also reduces the efficiency of your immune system. And all these changes are the body's way of saying, look, something is about to happen. So you can imagine then, like, if it's a situation where you obviously your life is in danger, when these hormones are released, you get a chance to sort of use it up in a way. Like, you know, you're fleeing from a dangerous scene, for example. But if you're stressed out, say, by, oh, I have to, I don't know, say you're stuck in traffic and you say, I'm going to be late. All these chemicals are released in your body and they don't get a chance to burn. And I think that is where then, over time, these chemicals that are released in the body and don't actually get a chance to be used up, it can affect your health.
Damage,
exactly, it can affect your health physically. So emotional changes as well, talks about having feelings like anxiety, fear, anger, frustration, and depression. And these feelings can also feed on each other and can themselves produce physical symptoms that make you feel even worse. Many of the symptoms can make you feel unwell, and then you then worry that you have a serious physical condition, such as, like, when people feel anxious, they feel their heart beating faster, and then they start thinking, oh, I've got a heart condition.
It's like one thing leads to another, doesn't it?
Exactly. It's almost like a vicious cycle. It's just one thing feeds the other, and it just carries on. Behavioral changes, for example, the person may become withdrawn when they're stressed, they become indecisive, or they become inflexible. They may not also be able to sleep properly. And they may also be irritable or tearful all the time. For example, there may be change in their mannerisms. So they may previously be mildly mannered, but now they become physically or verbally aggressive. So these are, I suppose, some of the things that we can look out for if anybody you know, like, is suddenly having a change in behavior as well. And I think an important thing to recognize as well is that anybody can have feelings that may that will cause stress or make them anxious at any point in their lives. And research has shown as well that 12 million adults in the UK see their GP with mental health problems each year. And most of these suffer from anxiety and depression, and much of this is stress related.
Really, wow.
Absolutely. And 13.3 million work days are lost per year due to stress, depression, and anxiety. And some people seem to be more affected by stress than others. For some people, just getting out the door on time every morning can be a stressful experience. And others are more relaxed and easygoing and seem to cope better with pressure. So, touching on the workplace, I found some interesting thing about, because I know in my line of work as well, I come across people who say, well, I don't know if I should tell my employer I've got a mental health problem, because, you know, they're going to look down on me, or they're going they might treat me differently. I mean, obviously, it's against the law to do that. That doesn't mean that it won't happen. Exactly. But I think now, with the awareness that people are having that mental illness is not exactly that strange, or it's not that we need to kind of lock you away because there's something wrong with you. But people are now more appreciative of the fact that anyone can be affected. We're all vulnerable to it at any point in time. So something, again, I found out, I was looking up Time to Change, where the charity, the mental health charity, I think it was important what they were saying about telling your, whether you decide to tell your employers and your colleagues about your mental health problem, it's a decision that somebody has to decide for themselves. But remembering that with the right help, people experiencing mental health problems can and do stay at work. You should not be treated badly at work because of your mental health condition and because others believe that you have a disability. The law is there to protect you. If you do decide to tell, think about how and when to do it and how much information you want to give, what kind of information and with whom to share it. Because obviously you don't want to kind of tell people by in the kitchen, like making a cup of tea, oh, by the way, I've got this. Because people who would not understand, they'll think, gosh, there's something wrong with you. But if you talk about it with your manager, for example, if you need time off to say have appointments, which is again what I sometimes encounter, it doesn't mean that having a mental health condition, the person will not be able to hold down a job or have
This is the thing, because when I had depression, it didn't stop me from working hard. I still did my degree.
Exactly.
And I managed to get into one.
Yeah.
I worked really hard.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes, it can even make you better at your job because you kind of throw yourself into your work,
exactly.
Maybe to keep your mind off things.
Exactly.
And also you're more sensitive to other people.
Yeah.
When you're going through something yourself, it kind of makes you more understanding of others. So you can even become a better team player because of it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, it can enhance your work in a sense.
Absolutely.
So, you have to see each case is individual.
Each case is different, absolutely. And I think that's where we just need to assess the situation and see what you need to do. Because at the end of the day, everybody's case is different.
Yeah.
But, the best person to judge what would be ideal for you or how it would work for you is the person in that situation.
Yeah. Yeah.
A quick lesson just to
talk
about. I know, I've got to squeeze this in now.
It
talks about the fact that there is a link between stress and mental health, as we've identified. And it also shows that there is a physical difference in the brains of people with stress disorders and those without. Summing up really quickly, the brain is made up of white matter and grey matter, and it says those who experience chronic stress have more white matter in some areas of the brain, which means then that there is a stronger connection between a part of the brain and another part of the brain, which would mean then that the shut off response and the shutdown response to stress can be impaired. So then somebody might feel a bit more, I can't cope with this, I can't deal with it. So there is biological, effects as well of stress. But just remember, there's eustress and de-stress. So let's have more of the eustress. I think I'll summarize it.
Thank you very much, Excel. Thank you so much. And we'll see you again very soon.
Certainly.
All right, guys. So it's time for the break. But after this break, we're going to be revealing our makeover today. And also later on, I'll be sharing my own tips on how to effectively deal with stress. So don't go away. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel, Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back to today's program. So we've been speaking about stress, and later on as well, I'll be giving my own take on stress and how you can deal with it. But now it's time for our makeover reveal. So let's take a look at a photo of our Katie before. It's on your screen right now. And now it's time to see what the lovely Gregoire sisters have done with Katie. Hello, ladies.
Hello.
She looks gorgeous. Do you like the look, Katie?
Yeah, it's great.
It's lovely. Is this the kind of look you normally go for?
No, it's kind of like a radical change.
Oh, okay. Yeah, they've got a habit of doing that, these two. Okay, so let's start with the makeup then. Megan, can you tell us what you've done here and why you chose this particular look for Katie?
Yes, well, Katie has really, really milky Nicole Kidman skin, and it's just absolutely amazing. I loved working with it. And we basically, there wasn't very much to do except bring out the radiance. And with tonight's Yves Saint Laurent inspired look, we really wanted to get the lights reflecting in those areas. So we did do a moisture base with a little bit of Croil and Silver foundation, just in the areas of the cheeks, just to bring out that vibrance, very clean look. Not much in the way of contour, nothing like that to change the shape of her face, nothing like that, no. And she's got lovely flesh coming through, just nice color. And we did also a double liner, which is with the red liner and the black underneath. So first of all,
I've never seen you do that before, that look.
Yeah, it's definitely inspired rocker chic with this look going on. She just looks amazing. If you look down and you look at her wings liner here, if you just look down for the camera, you can see that it's actually layered, and you can see that it's got the red on top. And I've done the red first. You can do blue, you can play around with it, you can do any color, you guys. So basically, have fun with it. Whatever you're wearing, choose the color. Maybe you've got a green that you haven't used in a while. You know, put that on. Basically, just define underneath with the black liner, not on top, underneath, because it's going to go straight on the upper lash line. So I've used a very thin liner with it's liquid, so it's got a very fine tip, and I've used this to just define underneath. So whatever color you're looking, whatever color you're looking to put on there, then you can basically define it with the black. But some people have troubles of where the winged liner goes. Yes. So I've got a little tip that I'll give you. And basically, the key is to grab a pencil or something straight, and you just put it at the bridge of your nose there, and you can see where it will end. So if there is anything, let's say, past here, you're going a little bit too low, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And you can actually see at the where the edge should go up, so you can really get in there with that defined cotton swab, and you can just bring it up. And you can go really, you could bring it all the way to the brow. You know, you could really have some fun with it. So we'll just go, and you can see there that it's basically on par with her. She's got a round shaped face, very beautiful. We do have some extra illuminators in there. So we've got this nice sheer, pearly, placement right in the kind of V area underneath the eyes. So a lot of people wonder as well, where are you to put this highlighter? Or let's say if you have a touchy cut from Yves Saint Laurent or whatever highlighter, because, you know, people get confused with highlighters and concealers, but this is where you would put the highlighter, just on the cheekbones, the bridge of the nose, a little bit on the upper lip and the chin. We've kind of got a blend of things going. So we've got this really nice orange vibrant red. This is Daniel Sandler Micro Red. Looks brilliant on every skin tone, every skin tone. And we've kind of mixed it with the 1970s, 1960s. They had a lot of the round kind of heart-shaped lips. So we did mix this rocker chic 1960s vibe into there, which she's very inspired by the 1960s. She says that she loves that era.
What do you like in particular about that?
I love like the hair, and I love like the flicks of the era as well with the eye makeup. Okay. I always go for that, yeah.
So we definitely incorporated a lot of her taste into her look and made it just rocker chic. Mm-hmm. And we've done the hair, so we've done, you know, we've got some nice finishing polish. I just got this free in a magazine. Not gonna lie, it's one of the best freebies I've had. But it's really just like kind of like a pomade, you know, the stuff that guys usually style their hair with. But if you have rather, any flyaways or anything like this, it's just brilliant. You just put a little bit of it in and you can just work it in. But if you just turn to the side here, it's kind of like a faux shave. So if you want to like pretend that you've got that cool edgy look, you can actually just section the hair from the behind the ear just to where it the head curves, and then section into four, and you just do twists, but you twist from underneath and then pin. So very much, and then you can do what you want here. We've actually, if you just look at the straight, there's you know, we've done this amazing pin, just a creation, wonderful creation here, but you could do anything from actually curl your whole head and brush it out and have that long, you know, wavy, romantic kind of 1930s curl as well. So I think she just looks absolutely chic. She looks ready to rock and roll. And she looks like she's stuck in a time warp from 1960s to 1970s. I'm so pleased.
Just as well, the eyes are also really standing out. She's got these beautiful green eyes. And the way you've done the eye makeup has just made them stand out even more.
Fierce red liner, where we did choose, because I was actually contemplating whether a blue would, you know, be that standout-ish. But you can, however your colors your eyes, Chrissy, you could do a nice purple if you wanted that, you know, that double liner, because your eyes are nice and hazel. And it's just like those types of things, like, you can play around with depending on the color of your eye and have some fun. Use the makeup that you're not using. And actually, I will be honest, that's a lip liner. So, you know,
all the secrets are coming out today, aren't they?
You don't have to go and purchase all these new items. Be creative, blend, and use these things. Do set it with a powder.
All right, thanks very much, Megan. So we're going to walk over to the stylist. So ladies, if you'd like to follow me. Okay, hello, Cynthia.
Hello.
Waiting patiently over here.
Yeah.
Our styling segment now.
Yes, okay. Well, with Katie, so as Megan said, we were very inspired by Saint Laurent and the 70s sort of vibe. And I think I've styled all of us in sort of that disco diva sort of look. Basically, I'll start with Katie, if you just step forward here. Yep. So with Katie, she says that it's radically different from what she would normally wear, but I did take the inspiration from her saying that she liked this sort of bohemian vibe. And when I saw her picture, you know, I really was thinking like late 60s, early 70s, that her figure would suit this kind of outfit. So I'll just start at the bottom here. We'll look at the brogues. Now, this is a more rockier type outfit. So out of Katie's shoes, we chose her metallic brogues because they just add that sort of rocker edge. And we have her in these ultra high waisted, which are very 70s, but still very modern because they've got a tapered leg, black skinny jean by Citizens of Humanity. And then it's all about mixing textures and fabrics in winter and layering. So I really played around with like all this black. I mean, next week we have our Christmas segment, so we'll go crazy with color then. But for now, we're just going to play around with the different textures of black. So I put like sort of a satiny kind of a cropped shirt underneath this fabulous leather shirt, which is quite rockery. And we've also added that bohemian kind of chicness with the tassel bag, which I've worn on her hip. And basically what you could do with this look as well to get that extra texture is, this is really in right now too, Chrissy. It's like that velvety kind of jean. Mm-hmm. And this kind of would, you know, just make the texture a bit different, and you could play with that. So that's something to look out for when you're purchasing things this season. But to top it off, when I saw the colors that Megan was using for the double winged liner and all that, I thought, you know, she needs to put this layer on, which is a poncho, and we've got the colors here that sort of complement the makeup. So still wearing this so that you show, you know, the satin layer, the leather layer, but we still add more tassels, we add a bit of warmth, a bit of layers, and what do you think about this, Katie?
Yeah, I think it's great. I love the tassels, personally. Do you?
Yeah. And is it comfortable?
Yeah, very. Yeah. Totally. Love the jeans.
Cool. I'm glad you like it.
She brings really comfy jeans for us to buy, I have to say. They don't look comfortable, but they really are.
Great. So thanks for modeling that. That was awesome. I will go on to Chrissy. So next I have Chrissy, and again, 70s inspired here. We are getting into that festive season. So Chrissy with a blingy top here, this would be an easy one to wear to a Christmas party. You could easily pair that with any trouser, any skirt, anything. really. What I have paired it with today, though, is the flare leg jean. And Chrissy wears these so awesome. They look amazing on her. And the big thing with a flare is you want to make sure that you pair them with a wedge. Now, if you don't have a wedge, it would be acceptable to wear a court shoe, but you probably want to make sure that you can't actually see your foot. So that is the look. So Chrissy, tell me about what you feel like in these jeans, because I don't think I've seen you in a flare.
To be honest, I've never worn anything this flary before. I do have bootcut jeans, so these are quite different. I never thought I would like them, because I've seen them on other people, and I don't like them that much, but they're growing on me.
I love when you say stuff like that. I never would have done it, but here it is. But they give such a nice shape, and they look great on your figure, so thanks for that. And Megan, moving on to Megan, we have, so every week I'm looking to style Megan and her growing bump, and we've picked a pair of very glamorous sequined trousers for Megan, and we've just put a form-fitting vest underneath, right, and the lacy shoes there. And we put this tassel poncho over top with the double tassel blingy sort of necklace there. So, you know, it's all black. It gives her a bit of color, a bit of metallic. I just let, you know, her red lips speak for her and the makeup speak for all the color this week. So how do you feel in that, Megan, this week?
Fabulous. I love it. I love the bling. It really brings a lot to the outfit.
A little bit of shine and all that. Do you like the trousers?
I do. I love the trousers. They're definitely got Christmas vibe as well. You could probably wear those to a couple Christmas parties.
Absolutely. And are they comfortable to wear with the elastic and everything you're finding?
Yes, absolutely. I do love the elastic nowadays.
They are
so super comfy.
Baby.
So does the baby.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks for that. With myself, I've chosen to mix suede. Suede is a very very fashionable textile for this season. I've chosen a fringed dress by Natalie Martin, and it's just really fun to wear, obviously, with a fringe, you know, with the movement of the garment and everything. We've got the suede boots with it, and if you want to mix those textiles, as I was saying, you could mix something like feathers, and I have this like cross-bodied bag here that would work very well. So you just get a bit of the color with the chain, and then you still get this mixing of textiles. So remember that. Layers, textiles, a lot of layering and mixing, and you're set for Autumn Winter 15.
I love that feather bag. It's really nice.
Cool.
Yeah. Are you going to talk about these?
Sure. Do we have time?
Yes,
do we have time?
Okay. A couple of minutes.
So I do have some colored things on the rail this week, even though we're kind of vamping up for Christmas. So you're going to see a lot of, you know, just easy things to wear, lots of color, but just sheer. You know, you've got that 70s vibe sort of incorporated in all the garments. So even these like electric blue jumpers, you have them having a roll neck, but they have that oversized sort of shape to them. So this one's
What would you pair that with?
This one, you could do anything with this because of the shape. I always give you that answer too, I think. But I would do it with probably black skinny jeans, the black flares like you have. Mm-hmm. I'd even put it with even like a black sort of mini skirt, I think would be quite modern with that. These pieces here are done by a lovely Spanish brand called Yersi, and this is something that I had chosen actually for Megan. I thought that, you know, being pregnant and all that, this kind of piece with the, you see how it's sort of adjustable there, but it's still one piece, I think that would look pretty fashionable. And, you know, it's important to still feel fashionable in all
course,
our stages, right?
She certainly is, isn't she?
Yeah. And like I said, Chrissy, Christmas next week or the week after, we'll do the show on Christmassy. We're going to see a lot of this kind of thing. So lots of bling, lots of, you know, 3D textiles on the clothes.
Lovely.
I mean, that's quite, you know, innovative. It's again done by one of my favorite brands, Essential, that I use quite often on the show, just because they seem to incorporate these new ideas on the clothing.
Different.
And it's just something you don't see every day, right? So I do love that. Another thing I was going to show the viewers at home, Chrissy, is take your favorite knitwear, your favorite cashmere, and don't be afraid to really like tuck that in, you know, to a pair of high-waisted shorts or a skirt or even your jeans and play around with tucked in knitwear. It does make a difference in the shape of the garment, and it looks quite modern, quite trendy. Just a few things to finish off you know, a few things I could suggest maybe for those staff parties that you have to go with. If you're not really into dressing up huge in those fancy dresses, you know, why not try a printed trouser on the bottom, something like that, or just go for a kind of a bold color. This is, you know, a bold deep purple, but it still does have that sort of, you know, 70s neckline, bohemian kind of look.
Lovely.
Wow, thank you so much,
ladies.
It was lovely being with you again. And you will be on our next makeover very, very soon. And guys, if you at home would like to nominate someone for a makeover, you have someone that you think really deserves one, maybe they've been going through a hard time, please do get in touch with us via the website, chrissybshow.tv. And you'll get these two lovely ladies with you to work their magic like they normally do. So Katie's going to stay with me, aren't you, Katie? Because we're going to have a little chat after this break. She's going to be telling us about some of the things she's been going through and how she's been coping. So don't go away. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel, Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back, everyone, to today's program. So we've been speaking about stress, and after the break, I'll also be talking about my own ways on how to deal with stress to help you guys out there who are going through it. So before the break, we saw Katie's makeover, and actually these makeovers are for you at home as well. So if you would like to nominate someone, maybe someone that's been going through a difficult time or someone that you think is just very special and they deserve to be treated, you can get in touch with us and nominate them via our website, chrissybshow.tv. So Katie is still with us because she's going to be telling us about some things that she's been going through in her life. And you know, this program is about talking about mental health issues, because the more we try to hide them and not and sweep things under the carpet, the worse the situation will get. So Katie's very bravely agreed to talk about the things that she's been going through to help you guys out there, to make sure that you open up and do talk to someone if you are going through something. So Katie, thank you so much, welcome back.
Thank you.
All made over and lovely.
Yeah,
brilliant. So you look gorgeous, my love, and I hope you've enjoyed the experience.
Yeah. It's been fun.
Oh, good. So I'd like, obviously, for us to discuss now what you've been going through, because you were telling me earlier that your depression started to develop from when you were 16, was it?
Yeah, I started to kind of notice it really in secondary school, about age 16.
Yeah. What was it you were starting to feel?
Just a constantly low mood, kind of, you know, it would be like a daily thing, ongoing, you know, just finding myself really unhappy. All the time. So that's
nothing
when
triggered it.
Nothing in particular triggered it. It just sort of came into my life, really.
Yeah. It developed. And this is a thing, because you don't always have to be going through anything traumatic. Or the same with me. My depression started when I was 16 as well, and there was no apparent reason. It was nothing like you know, sometimes it's a death in the family or some tragic event. It was nothing like that. So depression can actually seemed to come out of nowhere.
Yeah, completely.
So what happened after that, when you realised what was going on?
Well, when I sort of went to university, it really sort of it got a lot worse. I think it was to do with the kind of, you know, quite a stressful, pressurised environment, you know, doing exams and things. And I just sort of noticed that it just seemed to get quite a lot worse. I was also suffering from anxiety as well, having panic attacks.
Was that because of the uni stuff, or was that brought by something?
I think partly because of the university stuff, and just sort of wasn't really coping with it. So that really sort of took hold of me in my last year of university, when it was kind of at its worst.
Oh, gosh, right when you've got the exam.
Yeah, right in the last year. Yeah, very inconvenient. So I kind of, at that point, I was like, I need to do something really about this.
Had you spoken to anyone about that, like your family or friends or anyone?
I kind of like had mentioned it to a couple of friends before.
How did they take it?
They were very supportive, but I just found it quite difficult to talk about openly.
Yeah.
But luckily, two of my housemates, I felt really comfortable talking to them about it. Yeah. So that was a really nice support network that I had in my last year.
What about the actual sort of the university itself? Did they know what was going on?
I went to the student health centre GP and kind of told them how I was feeling, and I was recommended to have CBT.
Mm-hmm. Can you explain what that is for our viewers?
Yeah, so cognitive behavioural therapy. So it's kind of a logical way of working through what you're feeling and why, and how you can find simple solutions to these feelings in the everyday kind of scenario. Mm-hmm. So I kind of did a course on that, and also found my own methods as well, talking to friends or writing things down, how I felt, just as a way to kind of normalize it, but also have my own personal strategies.
Okay, so you didn't just sort of sit there and do nothing.
No.
And think, okay, this is it for me now. You were actively trying to do something.
Yeah.
And help, you know, to get
I kind
through.
Of realized that it wasn't how I should be living my life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good for you. So I'm saying that because this is what I want to highlight sometimes on this show, because I was mentioning in a show previously that even though, as we know, the statistics nowadays, it's 1 in 4 people will suffer from a mental health issue. We know that. And it's like, but there is also a danger that we start to kind of think, oh, well, there's so many people going through depression, so it's okay, it's fine, I should learn to live with it. But that's not the case at all. You shouldn't have to learn to live with it. There are ways out, there are solutions for it. And, you know, there are many people that recover completely.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Now, there was also another stressful situation in your life.
Yeah,
wasn't there?
I mean, kind of having that therapy and being on some medication and stuff, things seemed to settle down for a while. But then kind of graduating from university was another huge sort of change in my life. And I found that kind of triggered things off again.
So you got your degree and everything.
Yeah, I've got the degree. Yeah.
Well done. You see, you can do it. That's what we were talking about earlier, because sometimes we were talking with Excel about employment, and sometimes employers might think that a person with a mental health issue won't work well for whatever reason. But it's not true, because like I got through uni. You got through uni, got your degree, and, you know, we had some mental health issues, so,
Absolutely.
Sorry to interrupt.
But I've actually, I've spoken to my friends about this as well, and I think a lot of students graduating aren't prepared for kind of the big changes that happen after university life, and especially if you're kind of susceptible to anxiety or, feeling very low, that can be kind of a dangerous time.
Yeah.
So I found it just, completely shook me, kind of moving back to another city and
again, referring back to what we spoke about earlier, that stress and things comes not just when something negative happens, but also when it's just a change. It could be
absolutely.
You graduated with a great thing.
Yeah.
You know, graduated, you moved. It's normally an exciting time, but also because it's unfamiliar and unknown, it kind of like shakes the person, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And then unfortunately, at the same time, I was kind of going through a breakup with my boyfriend, so it was all sort of bad timing.
Yeah.
So it really didn't help. No, having a broken heart as well.
Oh no. Okay. But how have things been recently? How are you coping with everything? And
more recently, I felt quite positive. I mean, I'm a kind of get up and go person, so I've just been trying to look for opportunities and things to get involved with, trying to stay busy, even though of course it is difficult when you've just graduated, to try and get some work going and in the real world and so on. Mm-hmm. But I'm just trying to stay positive.
Okay, are you still having CBT and anything like that?
I've got a course booked for the new year.
Okay.
Locally. Mm-hmm. So I definitely want to carry on.
Okay, brilliant. Yeah. All right. Now, Katie, what advice would you give to the viewers out there who maybe even students that are going through something and they're kind of bottling up and keeping it to themselves because they're afraid maybe of what their friends will think, or maybe if people think they're strange? What advice would you give to them?
I mean, I think it's really important to admit to yourself first that maybe there's an issue or that you're unhappy, because I think that's like a really important first step to make.
Yeah.
And then find someone you feel comfortable enough to talk to. That might be a friend. It might not even be someone you know hugely well. It might be a teacher or a family member. Because it's just really nice to be able to have someone who can listen to you.
Yeah,
and who you can go to when things are hard. But I'd also say definitely try and get help for yourself. Yeah. And don't just put up with it.
Yeah, definitely. I agree with you, Katie. Bally, thank you so, so much for coming on to
thank
share
you.
Your story with us. Thank you. All right, guys, so we are going to go to a quick break now. And as I said earlier, I will also be giving my tips on how to deal with stress, because stress at the end of the day does come to all of us at some point, and some people handle it in different ways. Sometimes, you know, it can be a trigger and it can make you feel more positive and more challenged. And other times, depending on the situation and depending on the person, the personality of the person, it can knock them really hard, and it can lead to anxiety and depression. So I'll be giving my own tips after the break on how to deal with stress. Now, since we've been talking about treating someone today, here's an activity that I did with a friend of mine to treat her. Let's take a look. Hi everyone, today I'm here outside BB Bakery about to go in and to enjoy a lovely afternoon tea with my friend Motti. Hi Motti, how are you?
Hi, I'm fine. I'm looking forward to this. I just caught a glance as we were walking past and it looks so good. I can't wait.
It looks lovely. Okay, so let's go inside.
Owner Brigitte Bloch, also known as BB, brought a touch of Paris to central London, an escape from the hustle and bustle to the atmosphere of a chic Parisian bakery. Originally from France, BB moved to London in 2010, and just months later, with help from her husband Philippe, opened her first BB bakery on South Bank, near London County Hall. She opened her second location on the Queen's Jubilee just 2 years later, located a short walk from Trafalgar Square and Covent Garden. When entering either location, the hint of Paris is tastefully peppered through the decor, with original art by BB hung on the walls. BB pays close attention to the details. Each item is carefully chosen, including the vintage English china for the tea that is only served by the pot.
As you can see, we've had the most amazing afternoon tea today. I loved it. Motti, what did you think?
Oh, I loved it. Everything was so well prepared. You could see that a lot of detail went into it. It looked presentable.
The crockery and everything's beautiful,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it kind of made me feel at home, kind of my home away from home. Not that I produce all of this at home though. But it kind of feels homely, and at the same time you get quality food that you wouldn't have at home, yeah.
And you know, it was very filling actually. I've got a little takeaway box. Even the boxes are cute, look at that. So I'm taking that home to my hubby. Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page The Chrissy B Show. Oh. Welcome back, everybody. Now, today we've been treating one of you at home to a well-deserved makeover, and it's been a fab show full of advice and tips for clothes and makeup, but also demonstrating one woman's strength and bravery in the face of some very hard times. But now it's time for me to talk about my tips on how to deal with stress. So let's look at the first point, which is to have supportive relationships. So there has been lots of research showing that having some sort of emotional support helps people deal better with stress. So obviously, if you keep it all inside and you're not talking about what you're going through, you know, even if it's something maybe that's a new situation and you're trying to deal with it, but there comes a point where it does get too much for you. So it's always good to have someone that you trust, or a few close friends or a family member that you can openly talk to them about, and make sure you get some of that stress out of your heart. Let's look at the second point. Engage in stress reducing activities. So obviously, eating well and even things like avoiding caffeine and alcohol can really reduce your stress level. Also, exercising and getting enough sleep. You need to also relax, maybe take some short breaks, have fun. Even prayer and meditation has actually been shown to reduce stress. So it's very, very important. And going back to the alcohol, a lot of people, they tend to turn to alcohol when they're feeling a bit stressed. And it might give temporary relief. But in fact, even when we've had our doctor on, Dr. Rob Hicks, he's confirmed that it gives you that temporary relief, but then afterwards it makes you feel even worse. So it's not a way to go. The caffeine as well. Maybe you've got so much going on, and you grab that coffee and it does give you that temporary boost, but then you end up feeling quite low again. So avoid those kind of things. And as we spoke about exercise as well, stretching apparently is also very good for stress. And here's a video with Jane Rafter showing us some stretching exercises that she recommends.
Hi, I'm Jane. Welcome to your fitness top tips. Today I've got a little sequence for you, which is designed to help you if you're feeling a little bit stressed out and you want to stretch and relax. So it combines some deep stretches with some power moves, and it really helps you to calm the body and the mind down. It's really nice. So all you need to do to begin is float your arms up in the air and very gently lean back so you can see the ceiling right above your face. You take a deep breath. And you exhale, hands by your side, and roll down to the floor. So you get a nice stretch through your back here. Reach down to the floor and go as far as you comfortably can, getting some stretch in the backs of the legs. And then come onto all fours and let's go into a gentle cat stretch. So all you need to do is round out the back and lift. So you can do a couple more of those here. This really takes any pressure out of your back. Okay, we're gonna hold it in a flat neutral spine and tuck your toes under. Hover your knees off the floor, really engage the tummy. And then with your next out breath, lift the bum and press the heels back into the floor. Now you're gonna get a lovely stretch all the way up the backs of the legs. Use your shoulders and draw them down the back. And then we're just going to walk forward into a plank position where we're holding our body weight with our shoulders and our core, and then walk your hands back to your feet. Relax here for a minute, take a deep breath, roll yourself up to stand, and you can go again from the top. And I recommend that you do several of those, that series, and by the end of it, I promise you, you'll feel relaxed and calm. So enjoy, and I'll see you next time.
Thanks very much, Jane. So there's something you guys can try at home. Now, moving on to my third point on how to deal with stress in your life. Third point is ask the right whys. So if it's a particular issue that happened that was unexpected in your life, so avoid the kind of emotional and unhelpful whys, such as, oh, why did this have to happen to me? Why do I have to go through this? And think those kind of questions kind of get you so worked up and can even cause more stress. So you kind of need to change that and ask the logical kind of why. So for example, let's examine what happened here. This is the situation. Let me see what led to this situation. It's all with the aim of trying to analyze and avoid the same thing happening in the future, not to beat yourself up or get yourself worked up. So make sure you do ask the right kind of whys, not those ones that just get you more stressed. And if you're asked the right whys, you could actually get to the solution, to the root of the problem, and tackle it from there. Get to the root and find out what happened, what went wrong, and fix things. And then that will mean the stress is out of your life, obviously depending on what the problem is. And the fourth point is, tackle one thing at a time. So when there are issues that seem to be coming from all different directions, you know, there's so much to deal with, there's lots of different problems going on, you may not be able to tackle everything at once. In fact, probably you won't be able to, it's just going to be too much. So what I advise you to do is to identify the worst problem, the one, you know, that problem that if it's solved will make a really big difference in the other areas of your life that seem to be going wrong as well. So for example, if you're having relationship problems, those relationship problems could affect your performance at work and can also make you feel depressed. So what's the root of the issue? You could try to solve the problems in your workplace. Maybe you've been having issues with other people because you're stressed, but that's not the actual problem in your life. The main thing is you are going through this big relationship problem. You're not feeling happy, you go into work stressed, then you take it out on your work colleagues, for example. Then because there's an atmosphere at work, then you start to feel depressed. So one is a knock-on effect of the other. So you need to deal with the main issue, which is your relationship problem. So get help for that first. Talk to your partner, get counseling if you need to, because once that's sorted out, then you're probably going to be happier when you go into work. Then you won't be depressed. And so sometimes people try to deal with the surface issues, the things that aren't really the root of the problem. And then they might fix that for a while, temporarily fix it, but then all the problems come back because they haven't dealt with the root of the problem. Right, guys, so that's four of my tips. Hopefully that can help you with stress. Now, obviously, we have reached the end of the program. We're almost out of time. But as you've seen today, we have done a lovely makeover for someone that's really deserving of it. And if you'd like to nominate someone for this kind of pampering on this show, maybe there's someone that you know that's going through a hard time or has been through a hard time. Maybe they're not taking much time for themselves. It's all about other people. They're running around after others. And you see they need some time to themselves, some time to just think about them. And you can also nominate yourself, of course. So you can contact us via the website, chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet us at Chrissy B Show and also leave a message for us on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. And don't forget to like the page as well. Okay, guys, so, and also don't forget, this is your program as well. So if you have a topic that you'd like to see covered right here on this show, maybe there's something that's been worrying you, maybe there's something that you're not sure about, how to deal with a certain situation in your life. Maybe you're worried about a friend or a loved one. You can also suggest the topic and we will be very happy to look at all suggestions. And we could even do a whole program on it if it's something that, you know, maybe does affect a lot of people. So do get in touch with us. We'd love to hear from you. And also we'd like to hear your comments about the program too. Okay, and we are reaching the end of the show. So if you'd like to know more about me and how I dealt with depression and panic attacks and phobias and OCD and all the other things that used to go wrong in my life, you can visit my website, mylifeafterdepression.com. Until next time, bye-bye for now.
Yeah, you're telling me off. We're not even arguing, you're telling me off.
I still love you, Filippo Berio.
Stare into my lens, like look in there. Just look into the lens. Love it.